SpeechBot started because there were other allied health databases that were being developed in Australia focusing on other professions. So Pedro had been developed for physiotherapy, OT Seeker had been developed for occupational therapy, and there was a new one called PsychBot, which I became a foundation member of, that was developed for psychological treatments for acquired brain impairment, and it was a multidisciplinary database. And having worked on PsychBot and got that up and running, I could see that we really needed something similar for the speech pathology profession, and that there really was nothing around that was available to clinicians and students where they could quickly and easily access evidence. So in 2006, I approached Speech Pathology Australia, and they gave me some seeding grant funds, and we got this database up and running, and we launched it in 2008. It's really just about the quick access, because, you know, there are databases around like Medline, PsychInfo, Ovid, Scopus. There's a lot of these big databases available. The problem is, as a speech pathologist, if you enter search terms like I want to look for a treatment for people with brain injury, that's looking at their cognitive communication disorders, if you do a Boolean search with lots of ands, you can end up with 2,000 papers, and your average clinician or researcher doesn't have time to go through all those papers. So SpeechBot's been set up so that we do all the searching. We search 9 databases every month, and we basically look at all those papers. We get about 2,000 papers a month, and we search through those 2,000 abstracts, and we screen them for eligibility to be entered onto SpeechBot. Basically, to be entered on SpeechBot, it has to be of relevance to a speech pathologist's practice or future practice. It has to be a paper within the scope of speech pathology practice, so it has to be about communication or swallowing, and also people who are at risk of having problems. Those papers are included. It has to have empirical data in it. It has to be a fully peer-reviewed full publication. So we don't put conference abstracts, we don't put book chapters, we don't put conference proceedings. It has to be a peer-reviewed scientific article. So all of a sudden it's a much tighter group of papers for a speech pathologist to look at. And then we index all those papers so that the person can find them on our database. And then finally, the group comparison studies, so randomised controlled trials and non-randomised controlled trials, are all rated for their methodological quality. We have a lot of tools available, I suppose, to rate methodological quality. We chose the Pedro scale because it was a feasible thing to do. It's a very technical skill to rate the methodological quality. We go through in fine detail and look for evidence of specific reporting when we're doing these ratings, and so it takes quite a lot of skill. It took a lot of training for all of us to do it. To help others learn how to do it, we've got a free online tutorial actually on the SpeechBot website, so researchers or research students, so we have nearly all our PhD students would go on and do Pedro P training so that they can learn these skills and know when they're reading a paper what to look for. And so the training, we've put a lot of effort into this training tutorial, and all our raters have to achieve a certain level of accuracy before we can have them as a SpeechBot rater. So these have all been challenges in terms of making this very scientifically robust and sound, but at the same time making it a workable, ongoing solution for being able to critically appraise these papers on an ongoing basis. That's the challenge. When you think, you know, a paper's a randomised controlled trial, it must be gold standard. What we've found is that there's a huge range of whether some papers say they're a randomised controlled trial, and then it wasn't a random allocation of participants. So we've actually classified those papers as not non-randomised controlled trials. So it takes some skill to be able to tease out what is true randomisation, what's quasi-randomisation. Sometimes they may well do, for example, a comparison of their groups at baseline before they do a treatment, but they don't report it adequately. So it's difficult to tell when you're reading a paper whether these groups were similar to start with. And if they're not similar to start with, there's a fundamental flaw through that entire paper, if it's not accounted for statistically. Because if a treatment group is starting off and they're better before you've even started the treatment, at the end of the study, it's hard to tell whether it's the treatment that's worked or whether they were just better to start with. So reporting similarities of groups at baseline has been one of our lowest criterion where people are getting the point for doing it. Reporting generally, things like whether there's an independent assessor, whether it when you run a clinical trial, it's not that hard to, rather than you scoring your data, getting somebody else to do it, or building that into your research design. And many papers don't have an independent assessor. So that's another risk of bias. What we're saying is there are many risks of bias that could be relatively easily addressed in the research design stage, but it's not happening. And I think what the Pedro rating system has done, it's certainly done it in the field of physiotherapy. Once researchers become aware of what we're looking for in a well-designed study, they start designing well-designed studies. So the Pedro scores have increased on the physiotherapy database. They've been around much longer. They launched in 1999. So they've certainly demonstrated that having the Pedro P there for researchers to think about when they're designing their research has then improved on the reporting and therefore the validity and the believability of those findings. So I'm hoping with speech pathology that that's the same for us, that we, as we all get more familiar with the Pedro P, I certainly use it when I design my randomised controlled trials now. You know, I have a checklist and I go through and have I covered that? Have I done that? Have I got the independent assessors built in? Am I doing a between groups statistical comparison? So having those items in your head really helps you design a better study. And what we're hoping over time is that researchers will look at some of these tools and use them in designing their treatment research, and therefore they'll come up with more robust findings. As a researcher, it's really important if you want to do treatment research to make sure you're familiar with all these tools, because there seems to be a lot around, but they're invaluable in terms of helping you plan what you're doing. But once you start getting really high quality research, it opens a lot of doors in terms of where you can publish that work and the impact that you can have. What I'm keen for is for speech pathologists to think about using speech bot, you know, almost every day. If you've got a clinical research question, you should be able to get an answer out of speech bot in less than 3 minutes. So it's a very fast, easily accessible way of quickly getting the best evidence and being efficient about it. We know that we can take results of those sorts of studies and apply them with confidence, and that's what we're wanting to do, is give speech pathologists confidence about a paper, and that's in answer to a frequent reported barrier to using evidence-based practice is, I don't know how to assess whether a paper's a good one or not, I don't have enough time to read it anyway, there's way too many papers out there. So SpeechBite is trying to deal with all those issues and almost fast track you to a point where you've got a very short list of papers that you might want to look at. It may be that there's one good systematic review that was published in this current year, and that will summarise previous research for you and give you some direction. And I think that's the value. Clearly, as a speech pathologist, it's then up to you to figure out how you're going to use that evidence and whether it fits in with your practice context and how it matches what your client wants out of their treatment, and how it marries together with your own expert opinion. So we know that it's a multifaceted decision. And SpeechBot certainly doesn't give all those answers, but it really does provide you with the absolute latest evidence.